Welcome to worship on the Reign of Christ Sunday at Blenheim United Church. Next Sunday, on November 29th, the first Sunday of Advent, Reverend Bruce Cook will be leading the worship. Let us gather for worship. The light of Christ is with us as we gather in his name. Filled with this light, we make his love known in our caring for others. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Let us pray. Mighty and tender God, voice of the voiceless, power of the powerless, we praise you for your vision of a community of wholeness, a realm of peace in which all who hunger and thirst are nourished, in which the stranger is welcomed, the hurting are healed, and the captive set free. Guide us by your truth and love until we and all your people make manifest your reign of justice and compassion. We pray in the name of your anointed one, our servant King, to whom with you and the Spirit, one holy God, be honor, glory, and blessing this day and forever. Amen. This Sunday is Children's Sunday, and so I just thought I'd mention it because we're going to be having a speaker from Palestine, and the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child was ratified on November 20th in 1989. Children's Sunday is usually observed the closest to Sunday to November 20th, which was on Friday this year. We in the United Network for Justice, Peace, and Palestine in Israel, along with a couple of other organizations, had a petition, an e-petition, which is government sponsored by a member of parliament, asking the Canadian government to appoint a special envoy to investigate the ways in which Palestinian children are being ill-treated. And it received 2,451 signatures, and Paul Manley, the MP from, I think, Nanaimo, presented the petition on November 20th. He was the sponsor of the petition. It was recorded on Facebook. If you can find it, search for Paul Manley and you might find it. On our website, there's a request that you write your MP to support this petition and ask them to support the motion that was presented. Also on the website are some pictures of some children from Palestine, beautiful young kids. So if you can find it on the website, and I'll post it when we get our website up, I'll post the link there so that you can find that. The gospel reading this morning is from Matthew 25, 31 to 46, which is the passage that is designated in the lectionary for this Sunday, the Reign of Christ Sunday. And it is the one that our speaker will be speaking on. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly, I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you that are cursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison, and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Our speaker today is Reverend Dr. Naim Ateek. He's a longtime pastor and canon of St. George's Anglican Church, or a cathedral in Jerusalem. He's an author. He's written several books. And he's founder and pastor-rector of SABEL, the Ecumenical Liberation Theology Center. And the Canadian Friends of Seville that I'm on the board of is the organization here that has arranged for him and a couple of other preachers during this next month. His message has been recorded, and I'll be playing it here in just a moment. He entitles his message, Authentic Love Embraces Authentic Justice. Maybe. There we go.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. I'm grateful to Friends of Seville Canada for organizing a short series of sermons to be given by Palestinian Christians, and I am thankful to be one of the preachers. My sermon today is entitled, Authentic Love Encompasses Authentic Faith. It is based on the gospel reading from Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. Dear brothers and sisters, I greet you in the name of our Savior and Liberator, Jesus Christ. For those who follow the liturgical calendar, this is the last Sunday after Pentecost and is known as the Christ the King Sunday. Next week, we begin a new church year with the first Sunday of Advent. It is helpful to imagine and reflect on the liturgical year cycle. With Advent, we start getting ready for the birth of Jesus Christ at Christmas time. Then, through the liturgical year, we begin our journey through Jesus' life, from his birth to his baptism, to his temptations and the beginning of his ministry. During the Lenten season, we live through his passion, crucifixion, death and resurrection. We move to his ascension and to the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, when we celebrate the birth of the church. Then for 25 Sundays after Pentecost, we continue our liturgical journey. We are energized by Christ's presence with us as we walk together. He nourishes and strengthens us along the way. Despite our human frailties and weaknesses, we complete the liturgical year cycle with Christ the King Sunday. This liturgical cycle is repeated every year until we leave this life. The Gospel reading from Matthew 25 gives us a picture about the day of judgment at the end of the world when all the people of the earth are gathered before Christ the King. This reading prompts me to ask, was Jesus giving us an exact picture of what will happen at the end of the world? Or is it another parable, like several parables in the same chapter? Is it another metaphor that expresses an important lesson for the church? There are Christians who take this story literally, while others emphasize its essential meaning. Be that as it may, our faith assures us that when we die, we go to be with Christ. As Christ was victorious over death, God has given us the assurance of eternal life. Because Christ lives, we will also live. The Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Rome, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Since eternal life is a gift of God, I don't have to worry about the future. It is in God's hands. We have enough problems to worry about and to deal with here on earth. But before I draw your attention to some of these problems, I would like to point out several astonishing facts that jumped at me when reflecting on this gospel reading. The setting of the gospel is summarized in the words, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, all the nations will be gathered before him." Please notice, there are no questions asked about which religion these people are affiliated with. No questions are asked about their faith or even whether they believe in God or Christ. No questions are asked about which denomination they belong to. No questions are asked about people's sexual orientation. No questions are asked about their skin color. No questions are asked about their knowledge of the Bible. It's worth reflecting on these points. I would like to leave you with three theological observations. The first, love was the basic criterion that Jesus was concerned about. The only thing that mattered to Jesus was this: in your everyday life, have you practiced the love of neighbor? Did you extend a loving and caring hand for those who were in need? Indeed, Jesus emphasized the importance of meeting the physical needs of the poor and needy. But we need to remember also that in the Beatitudes, he also mentioned those people in the world who are hungry and thirsty for righteousness. Righteousness is justice with mercy. Where there is love, there is justice. Love entails relationship with others and respect for the rights and dignity of others. In my own ministry in Jerusalem, I have emphasized the importance of doing justice for the Palestinian people in accordance with international law, because international law guarantees justice and fairness for both Israel and the Palestinians. Israel must implement the demands of international law. The illegal occupation by Israel must end. The Palestinians must establish their own state alongside the state of Israel. Both peoples can live in peace and security when justice as defined by international law is achieved. I believe that the words of Jesus about those who are hungry and thirsty for justice apply to all oppressed people, including my own people, the Palestinians. When we do justice to the vulnerable and marginalized, we are doing it to Jesus himself. When we love, we do justice. Love is the heart of the gospel of Christ. Love is the hermeneutic, the criterion by which we measure the motives and justness of our actions for the oppressed. Love is the only test we have to pass when we stand before God. Secondly, does this mean that faith does not matter? It matters a lot. In our journey of life, authentic faith in God should lead us to love of God and love of neighbor. God is the source of all true love. Your love of neighbor is the best test for your love of God. As the Apostle John wrote, "Those who say, 'I love God,' and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from Christ is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also." In the letter of James in the New Testament, true faith is expressed in active participation in the affairs of people and society. James wrote that pure religion is to care for the widows and orphans. The widows lost their husbands. The orphans lost their fathers. Both lost their protectors and breadwinners in a predatory economy. We understand these words today as metaphors for marginalized and vulnerable people in our societies. Can these be represented today by those who suffer from racial discrimination, by immigrants and ethnic minorities, by people with disabilities, by gay people, by First Nations, indigenous people of the land, and by Muslims? The Jesus community of love sees these marginalized as children of God, our brothers and sisters who are crying out for justice, human dignity, and equity. Indeed, Jesus identifies with the least of them and calls them members of his own family. Such acts of generosity, care, compassion might be done wittingly or unwittingly. In the gospel reading, it was done unwittingly. Expressing love unwittingly becomes a way of life, a natural thing to do because it flows from our love of God and our love of others. Finally, in this gospel, Jesus prompts us to choose our future because it has to do with choosing Jesus Christ himself. In the words of Walter Brueggemann, the well-known biblical scholar, the parable invites us to probe why in an economy of abundance there are hungry people, or why healthcare in many countries is mostly delivered only to those with the resources, or why prisoners have become warehouses for poor black men. We can choose a better future for our society and the world. Most importantly, as we help the poor and stand with the oppressed, we must examine and challenge the underlying systems of injustice and oppression. It reminds me of the words of Archbishop Helder Camara of Brazil, who said, "When I give food to the poor, they call me a saint. When I ask why they are poor, they call me a communist." It's important to critique the systems and structures of domination, racism, and oppression, and work diligently to transform them to structures, to systems, and instruments of peace with justice and well-being for all. Someone has said that they will come for all of us when what will matter is not what you bought, but what you built, not what you got, but what you gave. What will matter is every act of integrity, compassion, courage, or sacrifice that enriched, empowered, or encouraged others. What will matter is not your competence, but your character. What will matter is not how many people you know, but how many will feel a lasting loss when you're gone. Living a life that matters does not happen by accident. It is not a matter of circumstance. It's a matter of choice. Choose to live a life that matters. As we begin a new liturgical year next Sunday, let us rededicate ourselves and choose to live a life of love that matters. Jesus said, "Just as you do it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you do it to me." May God bless us all. Amen.
The offering is still available at these sites, except maybe not the one by heat transfer right now until we get the system back up running. Let us pray. Lord, listen to your children praying. May we hunger for love and justice in your kingdom. Bless our gifts in the service of these yearnings. We dedicate our offerings to your glory with hope in the reign of Christ. Amen.
Hello, my name is the Reverend Catherine Stewart, and it's my pleasure and privilege to bring you this message to celebrate Children's Sunday. Children are an integral part of the United Church of Canada in all that we do, in all that we value, in all that we love. And so let's take this moment to celebrate children in our communities, in our churches, in our lives. Friends, pray with me. God, who calls us to love, we give you thanks for the lives of children. In the smiles of babies, in the wonder of toddlers and preschoolers, in the imaginations of school-aged children learning, and the wisdom they embody, we see your image, your compassion, and your amazing grace. May we be bold in our love of them as you are in your love of us. Jesus, who calls us to follow, you welcomed children. You taught that they are the embodiment of your kingdom, the essence of your goodness, and the reflection of all that is good and hope-filled in your world. May we follow in your ways so that they are not just welcomed into our communities, but deeply valued for all that they offer, for the ways that they care, and for how they see the world, full of possibilities, solutions, and dreams. Spirit, who calls us to wonder, may this time of worship be a call to action, that adults will join together in advocacy and justice seeking for the rights of children in our homes, our communities, in our country, and around the world. Particularly on this day, O God, may we lift our voices and make our choices so that Palestinian children might know safety amid war. May they no longer be taken from their homes and families, caught in adult political and military violence. May they know a world of peace and justice rather than fear and hatred. None of us can know the fullness of life until we all do. Bless us with courage to speak and act, with compassion to love and care, with hope to know that the world can and should be a peaceful, hopeful, inclusive place where dreams of children can flourish and grow. May your light surround us as we pray and live together, part of your expansive creation, in the name of the one who said, "Let the children come to me." Amen.
As we prepare to lead this time of worship, we offer to God our hopes and dreams for the reign of Christ in the world. We lift to God ourselves, each of us part of God's holy realm. May the blessing of God in Christ and the Holy Spirit go with you, that you may make a difference this week, bringing God's reign on earth as in heaven. Go in peace.